हरे कृष्णा डिवोटीज, प्लीज एक्सेप्ट माय हम्बल ओबेसेंसेस. ऑल ग्लोरीज टू श्रील प्रभुपाद एंड गुरुदेव. दिस इज वृंदा फ्रॉम बाल्टीमोर. आई वेलकम यू ऑल टू टुडेज सेशन. टुडे वी आर वेरी फॉर्चुनेट टू हैव हर ग्रेस ललितांगी राधा माता जी. इट इज माय ग्रेट फॉर्चून एंड ऑनर टू गिव ब्रीफ इंट्रोडक्शन ऑफ माता जी. Her Grace Laitangi Radha Devi Dasi is an initiated disciple of His Holiness Jayapataka Swami Maharaj. During her high school, she attended a Bhagavad Gita contest and won a prize to go to Mayapur and got inspired and took up chanting 16 rounds and later got initiated from His Holiness Jayapataka Swami Maharaj in Mayapur. She is an electronics and communication engineer and worked as a lecturer in CIT and PhD College, Coimbatore, and then with BSNL. During her college days, she was actively serving ISKCON Coimbatore under the guidance of His Holiness Bhakti Vinod Maharaj in outreach programs, temple festivals, college programs, and cultural programs. After her marriage in 2003, she had served many temples and congregations initially at ISKCON Silicon Valley and later at ISKCON Santiago, Chile, where she was conducting Bhakti Vriksha in Spanish and then in Manchester, UK and India. From 2013, she has been living and serving in Charlotte, where she was active in conducting Bhakti Vriksha, kids classes, book distribution and coordinating outreach programs. Right now, she lives in Toronto, Canada and serving New Ramana Dham. She still hosts several reading calls, programs, book distribution, etc. She is also one of the founding members of Bhakti Sangha. She serves by giving several classes for kids and adults and known for her powerful emphatic preaching. So, Hare Krishna, Lalitangi Mataji, please accept my humble obeisances. All glories to Srila Prabhupada and Gurudev. Thank you so much, Mataji, for giving us your time and valuable association today. And we really look forward to your class, Mataji. Please take over. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Vrinda Mataji, please accept my humble obeisances. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. Thank you so much. I don't deserve that introduction. I wish I soon become a nice devotee and keep serving devotees and Srila Prabhupada. Thank you, Mataji. So I offer my respectful obeisances and to all the Vaishnava devotees. I have been so much benefited by this call. Often I used to join this in Zoom call or in Facebook, and I have listened to Maharaj's wonderful classes and also senior devotees classes, which have nourished me so much. So I would like to share something in gratitude for that. Although there's no question of being qualified, but we are put into service, so we take up. So let me offer my obeisances and to all the devotees and Sri Guru with prayers. Om Ajnana Timirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Sri Gurave Namaha. Sri Chaitanya Mano Vishtam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamahim Dadati Sva Padantikam. Vandeham Sri Guru Sri Yuta Padakamalam Sri Gurun Vaishnavamscha Sri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunathan Vitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Sri Radha Krishna Padan Sahagana Lalita Sri Vishakan Vitamscha. He Krishna Karuna Sindho Dina Bandho Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhanusute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Mancha Kalpatarubhyascha Kripa Sindhubhyevacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Namo Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prashtaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swami Niti Namine Namaste Saraswate Devi Gauravani Pracharine Nirvisesha Shunyavadi Paschatya Deshatarine Jai Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadara Srivasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda. Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare Mukam Karoti Vachalam Pangum Langayate Girim Yat Kripa Tamaham Vande Sri Gurum Dinatarinam Paramananda Madhavam Sri Chaitanya Mishwaram Hari Om Tat Sat. Now it's Kartik month. Okay, so the topic today I'll be just sharing some anecdotes from Srila Prabhupada's life history. And Srila Prabhupada he's called himself that I am not a man to be disappointed. So this is Kartik month and everybody is meditating on Mother Yashoda's devotion to Lord Krishna and Vrajavasis. And also this is a month where Srila Prabhupada went back to Krishna after successfully establishing his mission here. Mother Yashoda had to struggle very hard before Krishna would give in and allow her to bind. So we can see the descriptions from Srimad Bhagavatam, how she was running around faster than him and ultimately caught him. And she was very determined to bind him, although because of his different shaktis that wouldn't allow her to do that. And she was constantly trying and couldn't bind the Lord, but still she was trying hard. And finally, seeing her labor, Krishna agreed to be bound. So similarly, seeing Srila Prabhupada's labor of love, that Krishna agreed to be bound in temples, if not for Srila Prabhupada, where would be all of us now, and where would be ISKCON temples and, you know, deity worship and so many things. That didn't come just like that on a plate to Srila Prabhupada. He had to practically struggle a lot. So my there is no one favorite. Everything of Srila Prabhupada's life history is favorite, because each day of Srila Prabhupada had so much to do, and what can 7 volumes hold? His Grace Sureshwar Prabhu, Srila Prabhupada's disciple, who has been doing this seminars of Sambandha, Abhideya and Prayojana. So he gave one seminar in Charlotte, and at that time he mentioned that he was one of the members of the team of devotees who had to collect information and then for the production of Srila Prabhupada Leelamrita. So he said that there was so much that they could get, but all of them couldn't be, you know, fitted in the book. And we can imagine that even they had collected a lot of information, a lot and lot more would have happened in his life. And this is also Srimad Bhagavatam. Srimad Bhagavatam we have thrilling stories of how devotees surrender to Krishna and Krishna reciprocates with them. And there is a constant competition which is endlessly rising between devotees and the Lord. So we can see that that's very much true in Srila Prabhupada's life history. And we can also assume that, you know, even the devas in the higher planetary systems would be reading this part of Srila Prabhupada's life history. So since I've been very much inspired, and I'm also inspired to hear the disciples of Srila Prabhupada in person, because that's a great privilege for us, especially our generation of devotees. And it's a very great privilege to be directly hearing from them. And also one thing I've noticed among many, many, many of them is that just like if you slightly even touch a pot which is filled with water, that's going to brim over. And, you know, the water is going to come out, even if we slightly touch. So like this way, Srila Prabhupada's disciples are always immersed in dedication, love, and gratitude for the spiritual master. I saw it personally in many cases, and in one case is that Her Grace Jayashree Mataji, who's living in New Vrindavan. So she drove to Charlotte 7 hours nonstop. Maybe she stopped a few minutes in between, but she had to reach on time, and she was, I think, must be close to 65 plus. So she was driving alone. Usually she used to come with her son or someone to accompany, but she was driving alone all the way. And we can imagine at that age, if you're driving alone, then how tired it would be. And we had the meeting, maybe an informal meeting, because we didn't know how Mataji would be ready for a class in Sudha Mataji's house in Charlotte. And she came freshened up. And then, since it was not a formal class, I was requesting her if she can talk a little bit on Srila Prabhupada. And she started, and it was about, when she started, it was 8 o'clock in the evening, in the night, and she went non-stop till 10:15, two and a half hours. So that was an amazing, personal experience for me to see that how much they are conscious of Srila Prabhupada, and very, very grateful to them for this Sangha. So I was inspired to share some things from Prabhupada's life history. Can I share the screen, Mataji?
Yes, Mataji, you can.
So this is Butler, Pennsylvania, the first testing ground. All of you must have read this many, many times. I know that I'm repeating it, but it is so, it's so pleasurable. It is so moving and binding to read these things again and again. So here we saw that Srila Prabhupada was sponsored by Gopal and Sally Agarwal. Sally is from a Jewish background. And Gopal's father is a businessman in Mathura, and he used to send a sponsorship letter for Gopal for many sadhus, and he would sign it and send it, and that's it. Nobody would come. So he thought the same thing with Srila Prabhupada. But then after a month after he signed, they got a reply that Srila Prabhupada is, Bhaktivedanta Swami is coming. So Sally was in a kind of a shock. And she said, oh, Gopal, see, this Swamiji is coming. And then they kind of got shocked at looking at his grave picture, what to expect. So he took the bus from New York, and then he came to Pennsylvania, and from there Gopal Agarwal came to pick him up, and it was late in the night, around 2 o'clock he reached, and theirs was a small townhouse. So they asked him to lie down in the couch in the living room. They had two small bedrooms upstairs, and they had two young children. So since there was no place, they rented a room in YMCA. And so Srila Prabhupada used to walk from YMCA to their house, and for talking to them, for even cooking. And we know that how he used one burner, and he used to cook in that. And side by side, when he used the refrigerator, of course, they were eating meat. So there were all kinds of things in the refrigerator, and he had to accept it. So this is a very wonderful chapter. How, you know, after seeing all this, when he's driving, how Srila Prabhupada felt compassion for this industrialization, and passion. Sense gratification and passion being in the top there. So his thing is that he used to come and cook. Morning, he had some cereal that he got from India. He would just have it with milk, and about 11:30, he would start cooking. And usually Sally's thing is Gopal Agarwal will come home for lunch and she would give him a sandwich. And slowly they started eating Prabhupada's lunch cooked alone by Srila Prabhupada. It would take 2 hours. And Sally would be busy doing housework and taking care of the children. And Prabhupada did it for a month. And then he goes to YMCA. And again in the evening, 6 to 9, he comes there like an open house and people ask questions like that. So, but they were very concerned about what will the neighbors speak about such a strange guest. So Sally Agarwal took him to a local newspaper and said and told that, you know, you can make a story out of him. And that's the Butler Eagle story that we read. Now that a picture of Prabhupada having Bhagavatam, and Sally says that he is, looks like he came to US to finance his printing of books, and he didn't look like a missionary, and he was a very, very nice person, wonderful guest. That was her comment about Srila Prabhupada. And usually, I mean, this is something that I thought we would read. After lunch, Prabhupada would leave about 1 p.m. and walk to YMCA, where the Agarwals figured he must have worked at his writing until 5. He would come back to their apartment about 6 in the evening after they had taken their meal. They ate meat. So Mrs. Agarwal was careful to have it cleared away before he came. When one night he came early, she said, "Oh, Swamiji, we have just cooked meat and the smell will be very disagreeable to you." But he said, "Oh, think nothing of it. Think nothing of it." So that was Prabhupada's thing. And usually when in the evening he would speak with guests, the guest would usually take coffee and other refreshments, but he would request a glass of warm milk at 9 o'clock. He would stay speaking until 9:30 or 10, and then Mr. Agarwal would drive him back to YMCA. So how he did his laundry himself, and he hung the clothes in Agarwal's bathroom. And to Sally, he seemed very interested in the American ways and people, because he's studying what is a culture, what is a people. And she also remembers that if he meets one person once or twice, he would call them by their name in the neighborhood or the evening guest. And the next time he sees them somewhere walking or in a car, he would address them by their name, and they were very surprised about it. So she was mentioning that he's a very intelligent and a brilliant man, and such a gentle man, and he was a very easy guest. That's what she had to say. This is another incident, another thing that I thought we would read. Almost every night he used to sit in the next door neighbor's backyard. We sat out there sometimes with him, or we stayed in the living room. One time something happened with our little girl, Pamela, who was only 3 years old. I used to take her to Sunday school, and she learned about Jesus in Sunday school. Then when she would see Swamiji with his robes on and everything, she called him Swami Jesus. And this one time, when it first dawned on us what she was seeing, she called him Swami Jesus, and Swami smiled and said, "And a little child shall lead them." It was so funny. So he was getting preaching opportunities here and there. He was, you know, Lions Club, YMCA. But I mean, here and there, one preaching opportunities. I mean, he knew that he couldn't make, it couldn't make an impression on people. And this was after reading the Butler Eagle article. There was this Professor Larson who wanted him to give a lecture at the Slippery Rock State College. So this is her realization of what was Swamiji. "I called the number given in the newspaper article, But it turned out that the Swamiji was actually staying in a room at the YMCA. When I arrived, he was waiting on the street corner and I picked him up. He seemed very much alone. When we were driving to Slippery Rock, I asked him to pronounce his name for me so I would have it right when I introduced him to my class. He said, Swamiji Bhakti Vedanta. And then he proceeded to tell me what that meant. Since I was not used to Indian names, he had to repeat it several times before I got it right. He showed no impatience with my slowness. Even at this early junction of our association, I was convinced that this man had an inner stability and strength that would be very difficult to shake. And this initial impression was further reinforced throughout the rather busy day. So he had two preaching opportunities on that day, and he was talking to the class and taking questions. And then she said that he was so bright and he was so engaged in that, and he never showed any fatigue. It looked like he could go on forever like that. And you know, she says that she had always seen him constantly repeating a prayer. And then, see, this is what he was sitting up cross-legged and we were speaking back and forth. He said that the trees around us were beautiful, and he asked, what kind of trees are these? I replied, they're shade trees. Then he said that it was too bad they weren't fruit or nut trees to provide food and benefit people. So that's Srila Prabhupada's Krishna conscious view of seeing every little thing in this world. So, yeah, then Prabhupada, we know that he came by September 13. And then when in the immigration, he had told that he had a sponsor for 1 month in Butler, and then he would stay one more month, maybe in New York, and then he would go back to India. So after a month, but there is nobody in New York whom he knows or where he could go. So there was one contact in from Mumbai. His name was Paramananda Mehra, and he had given him a contact of Dr. Ramamurthy Mishra, who has a yoga studio in New York. So he called up and spoke to him, and Dr. Mishra agreed to host him in his yoga studio. And that's when he's going to New York. And then Sally says that, I was very worried how he would go. And I know that he took a bath several times, what he will do there, what he will eat, where he will, where will he find things. He has to be everything on his own. And Gopal Agarwal explained to him how to use the coins and take bath in the bus stations. And then Gopal got a handful of change. And I remember telling him how to put the money in the slot so that he could take a bath at the bus station, because he was supposed to take a bath a few times a day. And Gopal told him how to do that and told him about the automats in New York. He told him what he could eat and what he couldn't eat. And he gave him these coins in a sock, and that's all he left us with. So, he's on October 18, just exactly a few days after a month, he went to New York City. And here, Dr. Ramamurthy Mishra was about 45 years old, and he is from the impersonalist Sampradaya, and he had not exactly from that, but he takes his classes and concepts from the impersonalism, and he has written a few books of self-analysis and things and other books that's all based on Shankara's philosophy. So he was a doctor, I think a practicing doctor, and once he started taking disciples, he stopped practicing. And he had his students who would come and listen to him speak. So in Srila Prabhupada enters at this juncture, and in his apartment, Srila Prabhupada is given a small room, and then so he was there translating and reading and writing. And then we know that so Dr. Ramamurthy Mishra is very grateful that he was at that point of time having a very bad health, because he was not very good in keeping up the food on time. So, but Srila Prabhupada had such a gusto that he would cook for him and insist that he eat on time. He was like 45 years old and Prabhupada was about 69, 70. So he was like, you know, old enough to be called, called his son. And because of Srila Prabhupada's cooking, and he had, you know, he had improved his health, and he's very grateful for that. And he says that he's Swamiji was a very friendly and a childlike person, and having innocence of a child. And when they got into discussions, Srila Prabhupada would, this is very nice, Srila Prabhupada would sometimes discuss with Dr. Mishra the aim of his visit to America, expressing his spiritual master's vision of establishing Krishna consciousness in the West. He requested Dr. Mishra to help him, but Dr. Mishra would always refer to his own teaching work, which kept him very busy, and to his plans for leaving the country soon. After a few weeks, when it became inconvenient to maintain Prabhupada at the apartment, Dr. Mishra shifted him to his Hatha Yoga studio on the fifth floor of 100 West 72nd Street near Central Park. The large studio was located in the center of the building and included an office and an adjoining private room where Prabhupada stayed. It had no windows. Neither it had a stove or a kitchen to cook. But before that only, Prabhupada was having conversations with Dr. Mishra, and he would say that how Krishna is a Supreme Personality of Godhead, and even Shankaracharya accepted him as such. But Dr. Mishra didn't agree that, and he considered Prabhupada as a threat to him, because once or twice when he talked, when he allowed Srila Prabhupada to talk a few times, that made so much sense to his students what he was saying. So, but since he was saying Krishna as a Supreme Personality of Godhead, which was not agreeable to Dr. Ramamurthy Mishra, so he became quite cautious not to allow him to speak. So during his classes, Srila Prabhupada would sit in the end and would listen. And then suddenly after the class, he would say that now Swamiji will sing us a song, so that he would be directly led into kirtan, and so tactfully avoiding his lecture. And even the students could sense that. So both were, you know, philosophically at odds. Yeah, and we can see what a test it is to Srila Prabhupada that before coming to America, he had written in Srimad Bhagavatam purports, Srila Prabhupada's purports, he has mentioned that it is his devotional ecstasy. And the purports kill our desire, Mayavada tendencies that is lurching in our heart due to material association for many, many lifetimes. Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschatya Deshatarine. So, I mean, and here he had to deal with such a person. But even after that heated conversations, he was still very friendly and cooking to him, taking care of him like that. But this is something that was interesting that we can read. But what a great inconvenience it was. He had come to America to speak purely and boldly about Krishna, but he was being restricted. In Butler, he had been confined by his host's middle-class sensibilities. Now he was silenced in a different way. He was treated with kindness, but he was considered a threat. Dr. Mishra could not allow his students to hear the exclusive praise of Lord Krishna as a Supreme Personality of Godhead. Spending most of his time in his new room, Srila Prabhupada kept at his typing and translating, but when Dr. Mishra held his yoga classes, Prabhupada would sometimes come out and lead a kirtana or lecture. Yeah, this is what Swamiji will sing us a song. I think this Robert Nelson is saying, one of Prabhupada's first young sympathizers in New York. I think Dr. Mishra wouldn't let him speak. Somebody told me Dr. Mishra didn't want him to preach. So what is the thing is that this is even more, I mean, so moving to read. Every morning, several hours before dawn, Prabhupada would rise, take his bath, chant Hare Krishna on his feet, and work at his translating. While outside is closed in windowless chamber, dawn came and the city awoke. He had no stove, so daily he had to walk the 7 blocks to the Riverside Drive apartment to cook. It would be late morning when he would come out onto the busy street. He would walk north on Columbus Avenue amid the steady flow of pedestrians, pausing at each intersection in the sweeping breeze from the river. Instead of the small town scenery of Butler, he passed through rows of 30-story office buildings on Columbus Avenue. And yeah, there are so many descriptions of the city things. And finally, he comes there and then he cooks his food, not only for him, for Dr. Mishra also. And where he buys his grocery, there is a small corner shop, West End Superette, where he would buy produce and spices for his cooking. Sometimes he would wander through Manhattan without any fixed direction, and sometimes he would take buses to different areas of the city. I think here, after coming here in this new room, he writes a letter to Sally. I hope to find that letter. He was saying that, you know, he goes in the morning, he cooks, and then I don't know whether he's cooking again in the evening, but he wrote to Sally Agarwal saying that sometimes I'm not able to sleep in the night because of night starvation. Because of hunger, he wouldn't have a, you know, late evening meal. Yeah, so with Dr. Mishra, he would go to his Ananda Ashram, that is 1 hour north of city, and there people would be chanting, and then, you know, Prabhupada would invite Prabhupada to do the kirtan. And while driving the one girl, Joan, she remembers that how they would have heated conversations in Hindi in the back of the car. And then after some time, it would cool down and then they would laugh and, you know, joke like that. And there he met this person, Harvey Cohen. And he has just now come to Ananda Ashram, and he finds it, you know, interesting to see the scenery than to meditate on the oval that they are supposed to meditate on. And then he was sitting there in his room. This is something very nice that Harvey says. I went to my room. The rain was increasing and beating against the windows. It was peaceful and I was glad to be alone. I read for a while. Suddenly I sensed someone standing in the doorway. Looking up, I saw it was a Swami. He was wrapped in his pink blanket like a shawl. Can I come in? He asked. I nodded yes. And he asked if he could sit in the chair in the corner. What are you reading? He smiled. Kafka's Diaries, I replied, feeling a little embarrassed. Oh, he said, and I put the book down. He asked what I was doing at the ashram and if I was interested in yoga. What kind of yoga are you studying? I don't know much about it, I answered, but I think I'd like to study Hatha Yoga. This didn't impress him. There are better things than this, he explained. There are higher, more direct forms of yoga. Bhakti yoga is the highest. It is a science of devotion to God. As he spoke, I got the overpowering realization that he was right. He was speaking the truth. A creepy, ecstatic sensation came over me that this man was my teacher. His words were so simple, and I kept looking at him all weekend. He would sit so calm and dignified with warmth. And he asked me to visit him when we got back to the city. Yeah, so there's so many things. And yeah, this is something, a dance performance that Prabhupada has attended on a friend's invitation. I went to see the dance with a friend. Although for the last 40 years, I've never attended such dance ceremonies. The dancer was successful in her demonstration. The music was an Indian classical tune, mostly in Sanskrit language, and the American public appreciated them. So I was encouraged to see the favorable circumstances about my future preaching work. The dancer was Bala Saraswati. Yeah, and what was his idea? He said that Bhagavatam could also be preached through music and dance, but he had no means to introduce it. The Christian missions, backed by huge resources, were preaching all over the world. So why couldn't the devotees of Krishna combine to preach the Bhagavatam all over the world? He also noted that the Christian missions had not been effective in checking the spread of communism, whereas a Bhagavatam movement could be because of its philosophical, scientific approach. So he's writing all this letter to Sumati Morarji. And in fact, Sumati Morarji wrote him a letter in Butler, Pennsylvania, telling him that you should not return until your mission is accomplished. So he took that as a great prophecy, and he tried hard. And so, you know, he's writing to many different people, his godbrothers. And then he's saying that, you know, I see prospects in this country. I see, you know, they all want, but I don't have neither money nor men. So if there is a little support, then I can continue here. So he's saying, if you agree to cooperate with me, he's writing to his godbrothers, as I have suggested above, then I shall extend my visa period. My present visa period ends by the end of this November. But if I receive your confirmation immediately, then I shall extend my visa period. Otherwise, I shall return to India. Yeah, so he wrote, and then, but then the reply came that it was not very possible. And he says, the reply said that, there is no, yeah. His godbrother did not argue against his attempting something in New York, but he politely said that the Gaudiya Math funds could not be used for such a proposal. Prabhupada replied, it is not very encouraging. Still, I am not a man to be disappointed. Yeah, this is what, you know, we see again and again. He's not a man to be disappointed. In fact, he found a little hope in Tirtha Maharaj's reply. So he described to his godbrother the property he had recently found for sale at 143 West 72nd Street. The building, only 8.5 feet wide and 100 feet deep, consisted of the first floor store, a basement, and a mezzanine. Prabhupada presented Tirtha Maharaj the price, $100,000 with a $20,000 cash down payment, and remarked that this building was twice the size of their research institute in Calcutta. Prabhupada conceived of this basement as a kitchen and dining area, the first floor as a lecture hall, and the mezzanine as personal apartments with a separate area for the deity of Lord Krishna. He had almost nothing in his hands, and what he was, what he had books, and he was, he had to depend on Ramamurthy Mishra for food. And whatever Bhagavatam sets he had got, he was distributing. That money he was using for his groceries, to get groceries to cook. He couldn't, there was not even a stove in the place where he resides. But he says that he would like to buy this, and it is $100,000 with a $20,000 down payment. And one time when someone asked Srila Prabhupada, he said that my problem is I can't think small. And he also said that, another thing is that I don't think before trying something, I don't think whether it's possible or not. I don't want to quote it because I'm not getting the exact words. But the point is, he wouldn't even consider whether it's humanly possible. He would try. I mean, that's what we can see. Again and again, he tried. Appropriately, Prabhupada described himself as a man not to be disappointed. He was convinced that if there were a center where people could come to hear from a pure devotee, the genuine God-conscious culture of India could begin in America. Yet because he made his plans dependent on obtaining an expensive building in Manhattan, his goal seemed unreachable. Still, he was persistently writing to prominent devotees in India, though they were not interested in his plans. they couldn't even see. I mean, what is this? Will this happen? Who has so much money to, you know, send this? Or that's what their calculation is, which is materialistic calculation. But Krishna and his dear devotee are showing us that how impossible is a it was definitely impossible to consider this for Srila Prabhupada, but as he would often say, impossible is a word found in a fool's dictionary. So he went on to ask Sumati Morarji also, helping him, quoting, writing that, you know, she could, because she is from the Pushti Marg and she worships Bal Krishna. So he says that, you know, she can help. There was no Hindu temple at that time. She can be the first person who could open a temple of Krishna in New York. And you know, that, and she's saying that, I shall request you to do this noble act, and it will be recorded in the history of the world that the first Hindu temple is started by a pious Hindu lady, Srimati Sumati Morarji, who's not only a big business magnate in India, but a pious Hindu lady and a great devotee of Lord Krishna. This task is for you and glorious at the same time. So he writes very convincingly to her, and then he's saying that, you know, please support this and take the credit. Now, according to his plans, he had a week left in America. My term to stay in America will be finished by the 17th of November, 1965. But I'm believing in your foretelling. You should stay there until you fully recover your health and return after you have completed your mission. Then we see that, I mean, this is so interesting. I know I'm out of time, but through some contact, he has got to lecture on God consciousness in Tagore Society of New York. And this is what the flyer read. A widely respected scholar and religious leader in India, Swami Bhaktivedanta, is briefly visiting New York. He has been engaged in a monumental endeavor of translating the 60-volume Srimad Bhagavatam from Sanskrit to English. I think I can read it because I would not be able to explain it like how we read it. November 28, Daud Harun had never met Srila Prabhupada. He was a musician living downtown and he used to attend the meetings of the Tagore Society up on the 64th Street. Daud Harun, I went uptown and walked into the auditorium. And I noticed that the stage was empty and a few people were sitting toward the rear of the auditorium. I walked forward down the center aisle because I usually like to sit up front. Then I saw an old gentleman sitting over to the right and he sort of drew me over to him. So I went over and sat beside him. And then I noticed that he was saying his beats. Even though he had his beats in a bag, I could hear them. And I could see his body moving and I felt very comfortable because this was something I was used to. As I was sitting there looking around the auditorium, he just turned around and smiled at me very nicely. He nodded his head and I nodded my head and he smiled and turned around. Then he turned back to me again and softly asked me if I was from India. I said, no, sir, I'm not from India. I am from here, the United States. He turned back and he kept chanting with his beats. Then he turned around the next time and I asked if I was a Hindu. I said, no, sir, I'm not a Hindu. I'm a Muslim. And he said, oh, very good, very good. Yes, many times I hear the children in India reciting the Quran. And then he turned back around and his body was moving, rocking, and he was working with his beats. Then there were a few more exchanges of pleasantries, sort of intermittent. And then a lady came up on the stage and announced that the lecture was to begin. And if the folks could give the speaker a round of applause, they would welcome him to the stage. At that point, the man I was sitting next to put his hand on my shoulder and said, excuse me, sir, could you do me a favor? And I said, yes, anything. He said, would you watch over my books? I looked down on the floor and he had several boxes of books and an umbrella and several other articles. I said, yes. I said, yes, I would watch over these. And he said, excuse me. He walked up the aisle and surprisingly, he walked up on the stage. And it was the man I had come to hear, Swami Bhaktivedanta. He walked up on the stage and introduced himself to the people and tried to get them to come forward. He said, come forward, come forward. A few of them came up to the front. There were mixed couples, many Indians, male and female, mostly middle-aged and some college-aged, a lot of professor types and ladies were there. Then he began a speech. He dove right into it. He just started exclaiming, proclaiming the greatness of the Creator and that the most important thing is to remember the Creator and remember God. He began to expand on God consciousness, what God consciousness is and how God is everywhere and how it behooves us all to remember God, no matter what we call him, what names we call him by, but that we should call him. He gave a demonstration which was very moving. He chanted Hare Krishna, Hare Rama and spoke about the power and saving grace in the mantra. He took a little break about halfway through and had some water. The last thing he said as he was coming down from the podium was that he had the copies of Srimad Bhagavatam. He explained that he had been working on them and they came in 3 volumes and were $16. Then he concluded and came down. A lot of people went over to him. Some were timid, some were enthusiastic. Some people shook his hand and were asking for books. At first, there were about 15 people gathered around him, talking to him and asking questions. With so many people around, he came over to me and said, sir, would you do me one more favor? Will you kindly take over the selling of the books? People will be coming to you for the books. So you sell the books and put the money in this little box and I will be with you in a minute. I said, fine. So while he talked to the people, others came up to me. They must have thought I was somehow his secretary or his traveling companion and people were coming over to me and asking me personal questions about him, which I couldn't really answer because I didn't know. Some people were buying the books or looking through them. So this went on and I was trying to listen to him, carry on his conversations with people and carry on the book selling at the same time. Some of the people were looking for a guru and trying to find out what he was supposed to be. Some of them were really interrogating him, but he just smiled and answered all their questions simply. I remember he told them, you will know, there is no pressure. You will know if I'm your guru. He suggested that people go over and read the books. And then the group dwindled down to about 6 and the few remaining were just looking at him and some were too timid to approach him. He walked over to them and spoke to them, putting them at ease. Later, he came over and we counted the collection and I helped him pack up his box and carry downstairs the boxes of books that were left. As we parted, he thanked me very much and I gave him my name and address and phone number and purchased a set of Srimad Bhagavatams. So we could see that, you know, practically this was before the 26th Second Avenue and I planned to speak more of to cover the period since he came to New York until he came into 26 Second Avenue, but that was like a huge lot to cover. I could only do this much, and we can see how he was practically alone, no one there to help him with the books, and a stranger. He engaged a stranger in helping him, and this is our Srila Prabhupada. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Our glorious spiritual masters, his disciples ki jai. So thank you all very much for letting me share a few thoughts. I know you must have read this many, many times, but still for my purification, I wanted to use this to glorify Srila Prabhupada. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Mataji. Thank you. Thank you so much, Mataji. Thank you for reading out this. I mean, speaking on this part of Leelamrita, it is so wonderful. Hare Krishna reciprocates to his pure devotees, to their endeavors and to their determination by giving the confidence of even achieving the impossible mission to make it possible. It's so wonderful. Thank you, Mataji, for talking on this topic today. I request devotees to please share your realizations or ask questions if you have any. Thank you, Mataji, once again.
Thank you, Mataji. There are so many exalted devotees in here, and thank you for letting me talk a little bit. Thanks.
Krishna Mataji, thank you so much, Mataji, for reminding us how Srila Prabhupada is very much determined in whatever circumstances he was determined to spread Krishna consciousness. So it's very inspiring, and thank you for reminding us again the importance of Srila Prabhupada. Thank you so much, Mataji.
Thank you.
It was so nice that you have chosen this topic, just like a refresher. Thank you so much.
Yeah, it's 125th year, right? And Srila Prabhupada, just the other day when they were doing Abhishekam for his entering into TOVP,
yeah,
I was reminded of this, that these things that he has to pass through. And I mean, I know that very less we get to read. It must be much, much more what happened every day, what all he had to face. But yeah, so I thought it's a good thing to remind ourselves again and again. Maybe, you know, we can continue if the next part, if anyone else want to do also, or I mean, later, if you have a chance, I can come back and we can do what else.
Sure, Mataji. We can do that.
Hare Krishna, Mataji.
Hare Krishna, Sudha, Mataji.
Pranam. Thank you so much, Mataji, for your association. And thank you for the beautiful class. And so nicely you narrated the past tense of Srila Prabhupada and how it's important to be conscious of Srila Prabhupada. You know, I really like that point. You know, it's wonderful, Mataji. Thank you so much. Yeah, so many points you have narrated, so much to learn, like, you know, and whatever you narrated today, you know, how Prabhupada is so determined, you know, he never looks back, you know. Thank you so much, Mataji. Looking forward for your association more and more. Thank you. Hare Krishna. And a friend.
Thank you, Mataji.
Anyone else has anything to share? Please go ahead.
Thank you.
Sri Devi Mataji.
Hare Krishna, please accept my humble obeisances. Dear Lalitagi Mataji, all glories to Srila Prabhupada, all glories to Gurudev. Thank you for choosing this wonderful topic of Srila Prabhupada and reminding us about the tremendous sacrifices and the tremendous struggles that Srila Prabhupada underwent just to give us Krishna consciousness. I think that it was so moving to read about all the twists and turns in that story of how Srila Prabhupada came all alone, not knowing anyone, with 40 rupees, as he said, hardly one day spending money in his pocket. And then, you know, he had such big plans. He wanted to do such big things. So that should give us so much courage. What are our little troubles and difficulties compared to what Prabhupada went through, you know? When we read all these things, we realize, oh, nothing much, you know? Krishna will help with all these things. This is not anything great. So thank you very much for choosing this topic and reminding us about the greatness of Srila Prabhupada, you know? If we are Prabhupada conscious, then we will, there is hope that we will become Krishna conscious.
Right. Please accept my humble obeisances, Mataji. I'm so, so benefited by your questions and the comments that you give at the end of every class. And thank you so much for inspiring us, being a senior God sister and an example to follow. And also, I was praying for your good health. Hope you are better now.
Thank you, first and foremost, for your prayers. And as for me, I must just thank all the devotees for tolerating me being such a nuisance to everyone and irritating everybody with my questions and comments. Because
no, not at all.
I don't know anything. And I ask questions because I really need to know, and time is running out for me. I don't have time to lose. That's why I bother everyone all the time.
No, we learn a lot. You know, it's your humility that you're asking those questions, but that those are really something that we can learn from.
You are very kind to say such nice things, but you know, none of them are really applied to me. It's just your mercy and your compassion that you're able to see something good even in something so difficult to tolerate.
No, not at all.
Nice to you. Thank you. Thank you very much
for your association.
Thank you. Hare Krishna.
I think we can end the call here, Mataji.
Yes. Thank you all very much.
Thank you, Lavitangi Radha. Thank you so much for taking out time for us today, and look forward for your association again, Mataji, in future.
Yes, Mataji, sure, definitely. Yeah, I'm behind Mataji.
Please forgive the mistakes and
thank you, Mataji. Mancha kalpata rupyas chakra prasam devata patanam bhavane pyo vaishnava shambhu namaha.
Thank you so much, Lalitangi Mataji. It's so wonderful to have you on this call, and we are really benefited by seeing how much love and devotion all of you Charlotte devotees have for Guru Maharaj. It reminds us not to take our Guru Maharaj for granted. Every time we see devotees just, you know, falling over yourselves to glorify Maharaj, we all sit up and think, oh my God, look at the love and devotion, you know. We feel like those Brahmanas felt when the wives of the Brahmanas rushed for to serve Krishna and Balaram, and they were busy doing all the ritualistic stuff. And then the gopis go and they serve Krishna Balaram so nicely and they're in ecstasy. And we feel like that, you know.
Look at we
are sitting over here, you know, trying to do some rituals. That's how we feel.
No, that's your humility. But the credit goes to Guru Maharaj, because he was the one who came to Charlotte when there are no disciples there also. He kept coming. First time he came, he spent 1 day. Second time it was 2 days. Then it was 3. Then it was 5. And then a week fully, full of classes. So, I mean, the love that he gives, it's impossible to, you know, even stand up and receive that. What to speak of, you know, doing anything to please. So just like broken glasses, we are all reflecting the love and compassion that Maharaj has is continuing to show us.
That's it. No, it's just amazing. Every time the Charlotte devotees, all of you come on and you'll extol Guru Maharaj's glories and you'll thank him so nicely. We are just sitting there, you know, open-mouthed, listening to all this, thinking, wow, what love and devotion they have for our Guru Maharaj. And look at me, I have nothing, you know. Example for us to follow in your footsteps and learn how to really serve our Guru Maharaj. Because please pray for him. His health is not so great now. So please keep him in your prayers. And thank you so much for your prayers. I'm really grateful. That kept me out of the house, I think, because so many people who got COVID had, you know, to go on the ventilator and whatnot. But I was saved by the mercy of the Vaishnavs.
Yeah. Thank you, Mataji. Please, we'll continue to pray, and we are all inspired by your example. That's what we come. We join the call to see the interaction and the love and dedication between you and Guru Maharaj. So that inspires us.
You are kind to see something that probably only you can see because you have the eyes of compassion.
No.
Exist in reality. Anyway, stop there. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Thank you, Mataji. Hare Krishna.